Hi, this is Sophie Fajedo from New Energy Investor. I'm here with James Allen, editor of New Energy Investor. If you're not familiar with New Energy Investor, it's a publication that looks at opportunities in the energy transition from fossil fuels. And hi, James.
Hello, hello. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Joining us from London.
I am going into spring in London. So yeah, good time to talk about the resurgence of renewable energy.
Of renewable energy. Yeah, it's been quite an interesting ride this year with the pandemic. It's just been the pandemic has actually opened the eyes to a lot of people to the energy transition. But it's something that you've been actually following for a long time, and it's something that has been happening for a long time. But I think the pandemic has actually expedited, no, this change in the eyes of a lot of people and businesses and governments.
Yeah, that's right. There's been a bit of a sea change in attitude, really, towards renewables and clean energy over the last year or so since the pandemic. I mean, before the pandemic, we were seeing a lot of the big trends come to the boil. You know, costs of renewable energy was dropping like a stone. Increasingly, governments and private money were just looking into sort of renewable energy as well. But then the pandemic happened, and that's just accelerated everything, really. The first thing we really saw was energy demand dropping, and that has actually enabled more sort of renewables to come on to many grids around the developed world, essentially. So I've been calling it sort of a postcard from the future, essentially. We've been getting, certainly in Europe, lots of renewable energy onto the grid, lots of solar, lots of wind. There's been new records set all the time in terms of sort of renewable penetration on the grid. So it's really been a postcard from the future at the sort of the grid level. But equally, what you're also seeing at the regulatory level, the governmental level, at a corporate level, and at the financial level, really just money just being increasingly thrown towards clean energy because they've realised that the future is in sustainability, and we have these overarching net zero targets of 2050, which they're even more determined now to reach, really. So it's been a real sort of perfect storm, essentially, over the last year, and we've seen clean energy stocks rise accordingly. It's been a phenomenal time for the stocks in the sector.
Yeah, it's been, for me, it's been quite interesting that one of the most fascinating things has been that it's coming, I mean, the interest is coming from pretty much everywhere. You have the public, which is quite interested. Then you have the businesses. The businesses are really, I think, one of the big drivers of change, no? Along with also the governments that, I mean, you saw China set net zero targets by 2060. Australia doesn't really have a target yet, but I think in Australia, what's really driving, I mean, we're still seeing a lot of change happening. We've seen a lot of rooftop capacity coming onto the, being added to the, being added. No? And then you also have green hydrogen. You have a lot of opportunity with green hydrogen. You have, for example, Andrew Forrest from Fortescue, who said that they were actually going to look at, making more green hydrogen and green iron ore. So it's quite a lot of things that are happening from a lot of different things, no? A lot of different places.
Yeah, I mean, all around the world, the story is the same, really. Certainly in the developed world, that they can see the future as being sort of green energy. And specifically, hydrogen is getting a lot of traction increasingly, and especially so in Australia. Yeah, you're right to pinpoint Andrew Twiggy Forrest at Fortescue. He's becoming a bit of a pioneer, really, in the hydrogen space. He's has big ambitions to turn Australia into a big exporter of hydrogen and ammonia. Which ammonia essentially is a hydrogen in liquid form. It enables hydrogen to be effectively transported and distributed much more safely and easily than hydrogen in gaseous form, which is quite flammable and you need to transport it at very high pressures. So anyway, there's lots happening in Australia, certainly on the private side. I think the government has still got a bit of catching up to do, really, but there's a huge opportunity for Australia, really, to take the lead and for exporting green energy and also for its domestic needs as well. Elsewhere, the story is exactly the same. We're getting, in Europe, in terms of like the building back after the pandemic, the EU is putting €2 trillion into green energy effectively. We're getting Joe Biden, the new president of the United States. He's just trying to, the White House is trying to push through this infrastructure bill, which is going to put similar amounts of money towards effectively a rollout of infrastructure. Lots of that's going to go into or billions of that's going to go into 90 billion, I think, is going to go into green energy. The last time there was fiscal stimulus like this in the US, we saw green energy sort of take off like a rocket back in 2009 in the Obama era. So this is what's potentially awaiting us when this bill potentially gets through as early as September, really. So lots of investors sometimes think that green energy, that the train has also already sort of left the station, and we've seen such an exciting run up in valuations over the last 2 years that it's almost too late for them to invest. But it's really not too late whatsoever. We have had a good time, but there's still so much good news coming out. There's so much good news awaiting us. There's lots of money still pouring into the sector by the day. That now is the perfect time to get involved. I think for my money, it's a bit of a one-way ticket, really, in terms of what's happening, because we all know really the future is in green, clean energy. So I'm an investor, and that's why I tell my readers to really sort of place their bets accordingly, really, because we all know that where the money is flowing into, and that's in sustainability. And really driving off fossil fuels from the grid and from our economy.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, there's like it seems to be quite early in the game now, because you have a lot of companies, but there is kind of building the infrastructure for it, and it's just a massive infrastructure. I mean, thinking about it, it's just a massive infrastructure build that has to happen for all these countries to hit net zero by 2050. No, I mean, it's the UK, they're just basically gonna stop selling petrol cars by 2030. I mean, there is just and you're gonna need a lot of metals and a lot of materials, really, for to get to net zero. I think that's one of the opportunities for Australia now, because Australia has not only we have passed amount of land, we have a lot of sun, wind, but we also have a lot of mining, lithium and cobalt, and just different mining that would be crucial for this. And this is just kind of the beginning for that could happen. I mean, it will happen for decades, really.
Yeah, that's right. We it's very easy to look at the demand side of the equations and look at how much demand there's going to be for these battery metals and all sorts of renewable energy. But actually, if you look at the supply side, there's actually a bit of a bottleneck coming, really. The supply side hasn't caught up with the expected demand that's going to, for example, just in terms of the great electric vehicle revolution, the rollout of EVs, the amount of battery metals, high quality lithium, for example, is off the charts, really. We're just getting started on a huge mega trend, and Australia really has an incredible opportunity, really, as having lots of access to some of these battery metals to really take the lead. And so if I was an investor in Australia, that's where I'd be sort of looking, really, because there's some huge, really exciting projects coming out of Australia to really source the great green energy and specifically the EV rollout. So Australia, as you know, they call it the lucky country, and you can sort of see why, because you're sort of perfectly placed, really, to take advantage. Obviously, it would be very nice if your government would take a bit of lead as well, but certainly the private sector is doing their bit so far. So yeah, it's very exciting times, really, for the supply side is often forgotten about in some ways, but that's where a lot of money will be made.
Yeah, so I mean, the battery, you've said it before that the battery is one of the things that we really need to figure out, how to store all this energy, and the battery is going to be quite important, particularly this year. So I mean, I think Australia is quite well placed for that, taking advantage of that. And we've had solar is increasing. Rooftop solar certainly is increasing, but I think it's quite a big opportunity, along, I think, with hydrogen for Australia.
That's right. Yeah. I mean, the key, really, in sort of the next phase of the sort of renewable rollout, really, is in storage, I think. And so batteries, whether it's at the grid level or in transportation, that's really going to be the key. It will help unleash the next wave of renewables. I think a lot of the spoils will flow to those suppliers of battery metals and also the producers of the batteries themselves, effectively. So that's why I think the next phase of the revolution will take place. Australia's in just a very good position to take advantage, really. I mean, You know, that increasingly, you know, cost has always been thrown at, you know, clean energy enthusiasts. It's too expensive to produce green energy. But actually, the costs have come down so much, it's not really a game of cost anymore. The economics are sort of irresistible, really, for green energy. It's really one of technology. I think that's the next frontier. And when I say that, it's really about batteries. It's about scaling up batteries. It's about increasing their range, their durability. And that's where lots of money is flowing into to really support that, to lift that side of the equation, really. So that's what we're seeing already in 2021. And that's what we're going to see for the rest of the year, really. Lots of money flowing into that sector. Lots of excitement. So yeah, just exciting times all round. Yeah, so but I would say energy storage would be a very good place all round for investors to look at.
No, there's certainly what you said about costs is definitely that's one of the things that we have to remember about the energy transition. No, that it's not also, I mean, it's good for the planet, but it's not just the only reason. It's actually making economic sense to do the transition. Like, I mean, you, as you said, like solar has gone down quite a bit. Then you also have batteries that are coming quite quickly. And I think that's one of the really surprising things about the energy transition. I think is that it's really happening really, like when you look at it every day, it's happening really fast. Like things are happening really fast. And the rate of change, I don't think anybody realized how quickly this was gonna happen.
Yeah, I mean, electricity, So renewables is the fastest growing fuel in history. I mean, it's eating up more of energy demand than any fuel in history, effectively, a lot quicker than oil did. And I mean, this is because of the economics. The costs have come down so much over the last decade. We're now seeing unsubsidized solar as the cheapest form of electricity ever in history. You know, we're seeing it's just incredibly cheap. Solar being put onto the grid all around the world. Some of the costs we're seeing out of sort of South America or some parts of Europe, Portugal, is ridiculous compared to where they were just about, you know, 5 years or so ago. So this is the rate of change, and it's not stopping. We're seeing new records broken all the time. So it's very, very exciting. And, you know, lots of sort of skeptics, they always say, you know, we still only see sort of renewables at 8 to 10% of energy demand, effectively. But, you know, let's see where it was just a few years ago. A few years ago, it was at sort of 5% or so. We're seeing, you know, but an investor shouldn't focus on the systemic change. So when will renewables take over the majority of energy demand? You know, that might take a while. Of course, fossil fuels have a huge incumbency advantage. They're not going to go away in a hurry. Of course not. We all know that. But investors should really look at the marginal rate of change. And that's how quickly they're taking growth from fossil fuels at the margin. And that's what's driving sort of these increasingly exciting valuations and excitement in the sector, really. So that's where the game is. Look at the rate of change. The rate of this growth is extraordinary. It shows no signs whatsoever of stopping. And that is what makes it incredible to the playground for clean tech and, you know, clean energy enthusiasts, because it's, there's lots of money being made and lots of money going to continue to be made.
Yep. More to come.
A lot more to come. We're just getting started, exactly.
Yeah. Well, thank you, James. Thank you for joining today. And see you soon.
My pleasure. Yeah, thank you very much, and speak soon.
Speak soon.